It's This Week at the State House in Rewind. Your State House review next. This program is made possible with your annual membership in the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Missouri River Energy Services, a not-for-profit utility providing electricity and energy services to municipal utilities in South Dakota and throughout the region. SDN Communications, constructing Project Connect South Dakota, a broadband stimulus effort for our future. SDNCommunications.com.
A bureaucratic nightmare.
Why would we put same-sex relationships up for grabs when we're dealing with millions of dollars of federal funds that we could have for abuse shelters?
We've had a pretty good session, I think. Over 400 bills, nearly 500 bills were introduced in the legislature this year.
You're watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.
Reforming education, state employee bonuses, and the general bill were just a few of the issues lawmakers tackled the final week of the 2012 legislative session. Hello and welcome to State House. I'm Stephanie Rissler. We'll begin with House Bill 1234. This is the measure originally labeled Governor Dugard's education plan. However, over the course of the session, it has seen some significant changes. We'll first show you the debate on the measure as it took place on the Senate floor Monday afternoon. On Wednesday, the House of Representatives had their chance to consider the changes that the Senate had made to the bill. Here are edited highlights from both days.
Those of you that decide to vote for this bill, are you going to claim ownership on House Bill 1234? Because if you do, I wish you the best of luck. In all due respect to the governor that brought this piece of legislation, it still has been a bureaucratic nightmare.
Well, there's been some talk here about horses. I fancy myself as a little bit of a horse guy. And I'll tell you one thing, after a horse has several surgeries, there's a lot of times it's time to put them down. They've had their day, they've had a good run. On a serious note, this bill is a serious deal. We're going to affect our teachers, our future students. Nearly every South Dakotan is going to be affected by this at some time or another. And we're making that decision right here. So my question to you is, show me the problem. We do a great job of educating our kids here in South Dakota. I beg to differ that we have a problem.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, we're never going to argue about wanting to achieve increased student performance. We're never going to argue about that. We're never going to argue about paying our better teachers more money. Never going to argue about it. My good friend, Jim Holbeck, the other day, said, our system isn't broke. We are. Schools are. After we got done chuckling about his comment, this gives them more money to put into the greatest investment that a school district could make, those men and women who stand in front of the classroom every single day. And so I appreciate your support on House Bill 1234. Let's pass this bill. Thanks.
You know, the one thing that really strikes me the most about this bill is that it really, at least I'm convinced, it lacks really open public and enthusiastic support from the general public. Now, obviously, this is a controversial bill, but even controversial bills have support from some segments of the general public. But I see little of that support in my geographical area.
Local control in this bill is not something that's absolute. And what I mean by that is all the time, the people who write the check have something to say about it. With regard to local control, it's not a Republican value to write a check from Washington or Pierre and have absolutely no accountability to it. And so I think there is as minimal amount of accountability in this bill as it relates to local control. There's still a lot of freedom within this bill with some accountability to a number of taxpayers who have been saying we need to be holding every dollar accountable. The other point is related to whether there's, you know, multiple topics in this bill. And as I look at it with respect to my friend in the other district in Sioux Falls, I see one topic, and that topic is teacher compensation as it relates to student achievement. And so I've tried to sort that bill out as it relates to that one Arrowhead point. Some of you know that I have said in a public way that 1234 is my least favorite bill of this session. I even joked 30 minutes ago that at the caucus party tonight I might start drinking, which, if you don't know, I'm a minister, so for me to say that, I thought it illustrated my level of consternation over this. And the reason I've been not excited about this is because I've held out hope that there's a way to do education reform in South Dakota without the people that it directly affects kicking and screaming, which, you know, I could say is some of what we're seeing at this point. However, I have intention today to continue with my green vote, which I gave last time, because I am satisfied with the amendment in this bill. That there is now a substantial window of opportunity and time for input and continual involvement from all the sectors of the education community. Somebody else has already said, hey, this is still a work in progress. It's not ready for prime time. And that's actually a point, that this isn't a closed conversations done today. This will continue to be implemented. There's the parameters of this have been pushed out to 2014, 2016, and all the key players to come to the table now. My main concern that we were doing ed reform without the people it involves being in the middle of it or excited about it, I really believe has been alleviated in this Ed Reform Advisory Council.
I think about some people say something about giving up the $15 million. Well, there's no money in this bill. And if there is, then this should be a two-thirds vote. I believe there was no money put in it simply because we didn't want to do a two-thirds vote. And you know what? I'm not running for re-election. And you know what? I don't have to have my arm twisted by the man on the second floor. And I don't care if he comes and talks to me about it. I think everybody needs to vote their conscience. And if you're listening to the experts in this field, then you will vote red on this bill. Thank you very much.
House Bill 1234 passed out of the Senate with a 22-12 vote. The full House agreed with the changes made by the Senate and gave it a passing vote of 36-33. It will now go to the governor's desk for his signature. Another big issue that took center stage this past week is House Bill 1137. The measure provides for one-time funds for Ellsworth, Medicaid providers, Teach for America, the Cement Plant Retirement Fund, K-12 schools, and state employees. Representative Dean Wink, who is the chair of the House Appropriations Committee, explained the measure.
We're passing out a sheet here, which kind of goes down through the numbers. It's a bill that, because it was estimated our revenue was going to be about $12 million, to the plus for 2012. This shows the distribution of that $12 million. And it also shows the employee one-time payment of $12,489,000, which is already in the governor's budget. As you get at the breakdown of the original, of the $12 million that is excess revenue, Ellsworth Air Force Base, the BRAC Commission is $500,000. $1.5 million of general funds will go to the provider, and that's new money. You remember last week that we put $20 million of what we thought was going to be excess from the Medicaid, from social services, into the emergency fund. This $4.2 million is in excess of that, so actually the Department of Social Services is probably going to have about $24 million over what they thought they might need for 2012. Teach for America, there's $250,000 there going to the board of, to the Department of Education. The Cement Plant Retirement Fund, that'll be a transfer from the general funds into paying down long-term obligations. There's a retirement fund for the employees, the former retirees of the cement plant, and that fund is underfunded. I think it's at a 91% right now. So that $1 million will go into that fund to help bring that up to 100%. I believe at this point they need about $5.3 million, but this will be a good first step to try and bring that up to par. And state aid to education is $8,689,000. That'll go as one-time payment. It'll amount to about $69 per student. These are all one-time funds. There are no ongoing in this. So if you have any questions, I'll try and answer them for you.
The full House agreed to concur with the amendments placed on the bill by the Senate. The final passing vote is 61-6. Its next stop is the governor's desk. The House also took up its first veto of this year's legislative session. House Bill 1116 will exempt bedding used for agricultural purposes from the sales and use tax. The governor stated in his veto message that such an exemption could hurt our state's tax base and diminish a steady, reliable source of revenue for our state. Here are edited highlights from that debate.
We currently are taxing these folks for that stuff as bedding. And the product he talked about in the old days, you just leave it out in the field and you turn it under. But what we're talking about is this last fall, it was a little bit chilly out and I threw about 6 bales of straw in with my hogs so they could stay warm. Well, hogs will eat about anything. And I went back in there about 2 days later, and the only thing that was left was a bunch of dust because they'd eaten a big percentage of it. And what we're asking farmers to do is to look at that pile of dust and say, well, how much is that manure and that pile of dust is actually bedding now, and how much did they actually eat? Okay, there's no way of figuring that out unless you want to go out there and you want to weigh every scrap of excrement and that little bit of straw that's left over. This is a good bill, and I'd ask you folks to go green. Thank you very much.
And the thing that I was going to bring out to you, ladies and gentlemen, when the revenue department person said that we even feel, even though it's your own straw, it's taxable, one of the particular proponents of the bill said, well, this won't affect me because we grow our own straw. And revenue followed up and said, yes, it will affect you. The other point I wanted to bring out, ladies and gentlemen, revenue stated how they really simplified the process. They knew it was a real hard thing to administrate, so they said, we'll just count your cows and charge $1.25 per head for tax for the bedding. Well, ladies and gentlemen, one of the committee members says, well, we got rid of personal property tax many years ago. So they were going to count the cows. Ladies and gentlemen, many years ago, we counted your cows. Now, I believe in fairness, and I think I've said that several times in this floor. If we're going to count dairy cows and assess them $1.25, some of my son has a big cow herd in eastern South Dakota, not a big cow herd in western. But if we're going to start counting dairy cows and assessing them $1.25 a head, when are we going to start counting beef cows, ladies and gentlemen? Fairness is an issue here. If we're only going to assess dairy cows $1.25 a head, when are we going to start counting beef cows? So vote green, override this veto. It's complicated, it's overbearing, and a really a tough issue to apply. But thank you. Please override the veto.
The majority of House members rejected the governor's veto. The final vote to override the veto was 68-2. Across the hall in the Senate, the majority of senators also agreed with the attempt to override the governor's veto with a 26-6 vote. Senate Bill 141 was another measure in and out of conference committee the final days of session. The bill, as written, will revise the legal definition of the term domestic abuse. However, the debate over the intent of the bill covered a wide range of issues. Here's part of that debate.
I just ask us to take a step back and think about some of the conversations that have gone today. And the one that sticks out in my mind is, you're reading way too much into this. All we're trying to do, the other side said, all we're trying to do is clarify the definition. Let's step back and look at what the amendments were. The amendments were to clarify that intimate partners or partners in an intimate relationship, of course, would not include dating. And of course, given our constitutional provisions in the state, of course would be partners of the opposite sex. What happened in committee? Those folks that are saying we're trying to clarify the definition took out those clarified provisions. They went back to this open-ended partners in an intimate relationship. Well, I would say, who's reading too much into this? I would argue that by them going back to the broad definition, and I know when we had the previous debate, the question was, is anybody afraid to say it? I'm not afraid to say it. They want to include gay and lesbian relationships. That's why they went back to the original language.
Well, this is disappointing because once again, I see what we've got going on. For the second time in this House, we've got a backdoor approach trying to deal with same-sex relationships. Coming through the back door, why not the front door? If that's what you want to deal with, let's bring it on through the front and deal with it directly. Let's not put domestic violence victims at risk. Article 1 of the Bill of Rights says we must treat everyone the same. That amendment carved out, folks, an exception. We are officers of the state, and that we as legislators are officers of the state. We have the responsibility to protect all citizens, whether they're boys, girls, men, women, same-sex partners, it doesn't matter. We have the responsibility to protect everyone. Why would we put same-sex relationships up for grabs when we're dealing with millions of dollars of federal funds that we could have for abuse shelters?
And I will submit to you that if we include dating and the other things that they want to include, it will greatly expand the definition of domestic violence or domestic assault or domestic abuse, and it will have a profound impact on the way in which law enforcement have to act when they go to that house. When law enforcement by statute shows up at a location and there's some evidence that there's been an altercation, they must, by our statutes, make an arrest. So they're always trying to determine who was the primary aggressor, who was the 51% plus aggressor. So if we expand this thing to where they don't even have to respond to a household, they respond to, you know, a couple of kids went to the drive-in movie and they respond out there and they're trying to figure out what happened, and one is saying that something happened, they have to make an arrest, folks. They have to make an arrest under our statute, and we're expanding this greatly. If we wanted to protect those situations that have to do with two same-sex people living together in a dorm room, then when it left this chamber to begin with, it would have been taken care of. There is an ulterior motive here. I would support the motion to not concur and not appoint.
The motion to not adopt the conference committee report and to not place it back in a conference committee passed 39-25, which means the bill is lost. On the final day of session, both parties took some time to visit with the media one last time. We'll begin with the Democrats, who had some thoughts on the passage of House Bill 1234.
Well, you know, I think it's overall been a good session. In the legislative branch, we've, I think, worked really well together with our Republican colleagues. And I found on the House side, Representative David Less, the Republican leader, has been, I think, really done his very best in a difficult situation in that caucus to follow the rules and respect the rights of the minorities. And I think the same has happened on the Senate side with Senator Russ Olson, the Republican leader. It's been an interesting session. I think the weakness of the session probably has been the weakness of recent sessions, in that the legislature just simply kowtows I think both to special interests and to the governor's office. And that's just does not result in the kind of policy that South Dakotans expect or need out of this legislature. It's a result of one party government that's been going on for what now 30 to 40 years in South Dakota. The same party has controlled both houses of the legislature and the governor's office. And in the result, I don't know if there's a better verb to describe it. It's kowtowing. It's important issues just don't get the kind of hearing they need. And one good example would be House Bill 1234. I mean, it passed not because it's good legislation. It passed because they could.
Well, ultimately with 1234, as you know, some of our colleagues on the other side of the aisle, they said, you know, this is now, it started as a governor's bill and now it's their bill. And I hope that they will take ownership on that issue, because, having something that passed by just a few extra votes in the Senate and only one vote over in the House, and really because there is no funding in this bill, the Lieutenant Governor, and in great respect to him, he told us that there is no funding when we challenged the two-thirds ruling. And had this been two-thirds, it would not have passed both chambers of the legislature. And anything that is so monumental and a huge change in what we are doing, obviously we know in terms of tax policy it takes a two-thirds vote. And here's something that just squeaked through with much arm twisting. And so we will see many folks have to own up to what they, what is passed in 1234, which is a clear increase in the amount of state bureaucracy in our school system and taking away that local control.
The Republicans also took some time to visit with the media. They also touched on House Bill 1234 and reflected on this year's legislative session.
1234 represents a different direction in addressing education funding and student achievement, frankly. The governor has said, and we've agreed with him, that student achievement is the highest priority. Teachers are the critical factor in that priority, and we are going to do something to target funds for teachers. To me, it is a new approach for South Dakota. It's certainly not new for the nation when you've got the Obama administration pressing many of these same initiatives and states across the country doing it. What I like most about 1234 in its form now is the degree of flexibility school districts will have to try different methods of evaluation and accountability, because that is the key, accountability. So we'll have 152 school districts trying a multitude of different ways to get to accountability models. What we can do then with those 152 different approaches is take what's working best over the long term and spread that throughout the state. It's almost as if we have 152 incubators of ideas to improve student achievement, to develop accountability models, and that I think is something that may have been lost in the debate.
Governor Dennis Dugard also took some time to visit with the media and gave his thoughts on this year's legislative session. He also announced an upcoming trip to China that would benefit several South Dakota businesses. Here is Governor Dennis Dugard.
The session is winding to a close. The main run of session is closing today if the legislature gets its work done, and I believe they will. We've had a pretty good session, I think. Over 400 bills, nearly 500 bills were introduced in the legislature this year, and they've made their way through their respective committees and houses. I think it's noteworthy that in South Dakota, we should be proud of our process in the legislative arena, because unlike the old days in South Dakota, where a committee chairman who didn't like a bill could simply put it in his pocket and never schedule a hearing, or if the legislative leader in one of the houses of the legislature didn't like a bill, they could simply not schedule it for hearing. South Dakota rules disallow that, and every bill gets a full hearing in committee, and if the full House wants to hear it, they can force it out of committee if the committee doesn't send it there. And so each bill has a chance to be heard by the legislature and have a fair shot at passage or failure on its merits. The other subject I wanted to visit with you about before opening the question is a planned trip to China. More than 420 South Dakota companies export over $1 billion worth of products each year from South Dakota. And of course, the primary products they export include manufactured food, transportation, electrical equipment, and fabricated metal products. And overseas markets are an increasingly important aspect of our export. And I'm hoping that this trip will help us find additional markets for some of our manufacturers in South Dakota. We are partnering with the state of North Dakota on this trip. The North Dakota Trade Office had already planned this trip and invited us to join them at our own expense, of course, but they will help us make contacts, and because they've been doing this for a number of years successfully, they're going to help us learn how they do it so we can not reinvent the wheel. On this trip, I'll be accompanied by Kohlberg Pioneer, a Yankton company that manufactures concrete paving equipment. Also, Lloyd Corporation, which is a company that manufactures ductwork cleaning machine, really an innovative and inventive product. Daktronics, of course, makes electronic scoreboards, and Masaba Manufacturing, which manufactures conveyor belt and equipment that manages aggregate in the construction and mining industry.
Each year, the final bill to be considered is the General Appropriations Bill. Unfortunately, the legislature was unable to complete their business on the issue by the time our deadline rolled around. The full debate on the measure is archived on our website at sdpb.org/statehouse. And that will wrap up the 2012 legislative session. State lawmakers and our SDPB crew will return to Pierre on March 19th to consider any gubernatorial vetoes. On behalf of all of us with South Dakota Public Broadcasting, I'm Stephanie Rissler, and we appreciate your continued support. Good night.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges. Programming is made possible with your annual membership in the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Additional funding provided by Missouri River Energy Services, a not-for-profit utility providing electricity and energy services to municipal utilities in South Dakota and throughout the region. SDN Communications, integrating phone and data technology for your office. Learn more at sdncommunications.com.